Our speaker today, Christian Picciolini, was born and raised on the south side of Chicago in the working-class neighborhood of Blue Island, the birthplace of the American white power skinhead movement. At 14 years old, he became entrenched in the first neo-Nazi skinhead gang in the United States. From violence to weapons, he immersed himself in the racist skinhead culture at an early age and quickly became one of the movement's most respected leaders and musical influencers. But if that were the end of the story, Mr. Picciolini wouldn't be with us here today. In 2009, he co-founded Life After Hate, a nonprofit organization dedicated to helping communities and organizations gain the knowledge necessary to implement long-term solutions that counter all types of racism and violent extremism. He went on to earn a degree in international relations from DePaul University, started his own global multimedia company, and was appointed a member of the Chicago Grammy Rock Committee and a board member for the Chicago International Movies and Music Festival. In 2016, he won an Emmy for directing and producing Exit USA's public service announcement, There is Life After Hate. He has become a noted speaker, media commentator, and subject matter expert in far-right violent extremism. In 2015, he published his memoirs, Romantic Violence, Memoirs of an American Skinhead. There's more I could add, but let's hear from Mr. Picciolini himself, speaking to us on Life After Hate, one man's transformation from violent extremism to proponent of peace. Mr. Picciolini.
Hello, good morning.
Is my microphone on?
Yes.
Okay, good. I didn't really know what an ethical humanist was before I came here, and then I looked it up on the website and I did some research, and I'm happy to say that I consider myself an ethical humanist, so I feel very at home here. Don't yay me yet. My journey here started 22 years ago. In 1995, when I left the American neo-Nazi skinhead movement that I helped build. I was 22 years old at the time, but I had already spent 8 years as part of America's first neo-Nazi skinhead group. But before that, I was a pretty normal teenage kid. Looked a little bit like Chachi, if you know Happy Days. I wish I still had that hair, but I don't. But I was a normal kid. I came from a great home with a loving family. My parents were Italian immigrants who came to the United States in the mid-1960s in search of the American dream. And when they got here, at a very young age, they realized they had to work very, very hard for everything that they had. So when I was born in 1973, they went to work. And that work kept them away from home 7 days a week, sometimes 14 hours a day. So like most other teenagers, you know, I went through a learning period where I felt that I had low self-esteem. I had low opinion of myself, and my insecurity was at a very, very high rate. But I also like to do the normal things that teenagers did. I love to chase girls, and I love to play sports. But I was picked on quite a bit because of my Italian heritage. When I was born, my parents decided to move us away to another suburb that was not very Italian. The one that they had settled in had seen a lot of the same people from their town in Italy move there as well. So I kind of rode the fine line in between both cultures. I didn't know if I was an Italian American. I didn't really know if I was an American. I didn't fit in to the Italian kids. I was a sellout, and to, you know, the American kids, I was the weird foreign kids, so I never really knew exactly where I fit in. So I spent a lot of time on my own trying to figure that out. Until one day, when I was 14 years old, I was standing in an alley and I was smoking a joint, contemplating what my spot in the world would be. And like a scene out of a movie, and I'll never forget this, a man drove up in a car in a 1968 Firebird and he screeched to a halt 6 inches from where I was standing. And he got out of the car, and he had a shaved head and boots, and he walked over to me, and he grabbed the joint out of my mouth, and he said, "Don't you know that that's what the communists and the Jews want you to do to keep you docile?" I was 14 years old. I really didn't know what a communist was, aside from, you know, the villain in the Rocky movie. I don't think I had met a Jewish person, and I hardly knew what the word docile meant. But I was suddenly struck with this man's charisma. He was 26 years old, and I was 14 in 1987. And he was powerful. He seemed to be the person that I wanted to be. Of course, nobody knew what a skinhead was in 1987. And when I saw his shaved head and his boots, it didn't dawn on me what he was. And his words didn't even really register with me. I didn't understand politics at 14 years old. I didn't even really understand the intricacies of, you know, race relations or anything else. But I was struck with the power that I felt this man exude. At a time when I felt the most powerless and the most vulnerable, this man was promising me some sort of paradise. And then he started to tell me, as I would ride my little red bike up and down the alley every day just to be a little bit closer to this guy, to try and understand what his group was about, he started to tell me that if I was not careful, that people were going to attack my European heritage, my white culture. And again, I really didn't understand exactly what he was saying, but I certainly was very proud of my Italian heritage, even though I was a little bit ashamed of it in American circles. I was ashamed that my parents didn't speak great English, but I also inside was very proud of where I came from because I really didn't know anything else. I was raised in that bubble. So one day I was riding that little red bike to baseball practice, the same red bike that I would ride up and down the alley, and I was stopped by three black teenagers and I was beaten up and my bike was stolen. And then suddenly everything that this man, who happened to be America's first neo-Nazi skinhead, was telling me started to make sense to me. He would tell me that blacks were moving into our neighborhood to commit crimes, that immigrants were coming into our country to take jobs. Despite the fact that my parents were immigrants, I didn't really pay attention to that part. And that everybody who was not like me was there to destroy my white culture, my European culture. So when these kids beat me up and stole my bike, it seemed to make everything that he said make sense to me. Suddenly I thought, well, he's right. Blacks are coming into my neighborhood to commit crimes. I'm the victim of that crime. And suddenly my opinion of every black person changed. Because I'd never had any contact with any black people, I based all my opinions on that one experience. About a year after I was recruited by this man, he was arrested and sent to prison for 10 years for a series of violent hate crimes. The most violent of which got him arrested, was him and several of his colleagues from this group going to another female skinhead's house who was part of this group, who they saw with a black man at a bus stop. And they went to her apartment and they kicked in her door and they beat her to within an inch of her life. And then they painted a swastika on her wall with her own blood. And they were arrested for that, thankfully. But also, as kind of a turn of bad luck, I saw that as an opportunity for me to step in to the leadership position of this very infamous group. It was America's first neo-Nazi skinhead group. And suddenly, this kid, who went from feeling very powerless at 14, now at 16 years old, felt very powerful. And the kid with the nice hair suddenly went to the kid with no hair, right there. And I started to understand what I thought was power. It wasn't real power, it was false power. It wasn't real respect, it was fear. But I started to, at 16 years old, get into a position where I was leading other people. And because I was associated with this very infamous gang, started to feel very powerful. And all that powerlessness that I'd felt for 16 years before started to fade away. And I started to direct my anger that I felt at myself against other people. I started to blame everybody else for the problems that I had. In fact, because I've had such low self-esteem and such low self-confidence, I hated other people because I really hated myself. I was projecting my pain onto anybody else that I could project it onto. just so that I wouldn't feel it myself. I started to teach other people that I was recruiting, because by now I had learned how to recruit other people. I had started to teach them the same type of rhetoric and propaganda that had ensnared me. I started to tell people that the Jews controlled the finance system and the media and the government. I started to tell people that immigrants were coming into our country to rape women and to sell drugs. I started to tell people that I was recruiting that blacks were going to commit crimes. And I started to use the propaganda of fear. I started to scare people based on how vulnerable I thought that they were, on what fringes I found them. I was able to key in on exactly what scared them the most and use that to recruit them. We hear a lot of the same rhetoric today, 30 years later. And I can tell you that, having been through it, that this rhetoric is very familiar to me. Now, it may be a little bit more palatable to the masses. It may not use some of the nasty words that we use. Maybe sometimes it does. But I can tell you that this comes from a place of experience for me, because I used to say those exact same things, some of the same things that we're hearing today. One thing I figured out during my time in the movement from 1987 to 1995 was that music played a very powerful, had a very powerful place in this movement, because it was able to gather young people together. Music evokes emotion. It's a powerful tool. And we could use it as propaganda and as an education vehicle. So I started one of America's first neo-Nazi skinhead bands in 1990, and my lyrics were about teaching people the same lies that I believed, the same lies that were used to bring me into this movement, about believing that the white race was superior, that other people were out to get us, and that there was a white genocide going on that was being called diversity. And that if we were not careful, all of that would be taken away from us, and that there would be a white genocide. So I started to use that same fear tactic to encourage other people to join my group. In 1992, I was in America's first skinhead band to leave the United States and play a concert in Germany in front of 4,000 skinheads from all over Europe. Now, the concert was in a very small town called Weimar, Germany, which was part of old East Germany. It's a beautiful city with a lot of history. It's produced a lot of philosophers and artists and musicians over history. But on that day, it was as if 1933 Germany had come all over again. And these 4,000 skinheads went out into the town after hearing my music, the words that I sang, the words that instructed them on what to do. They went out into this town and they broke shop windows. They stole beer from pubs. And they beat up the very people that lived in this town. German people, mind you, white German people. So at that moment, I started to realize that my words had consequences. Now, I'd seen it before, but I'd never seen it on this scale. And I started to understand that the choice of words that I used and the way that I chose to relay them were having a massive impact on people. So I started to really question my beliefs and why I was doing this. If these people were going out and beating up their own people, I had to really reassess why I was doing this. Was something wrong with my philosophy? And I started to understand that my words had consequences. On that trip, I brought my future wife, and at 19 years old, when we got back, we got married and we had our first child. And I can tell you that that further confused me, because our mantra in the white supremacist movement was what we call the 14 words. We must secure the existence of our future. We must secure the existence of our race and a future for white children. And here I was holding my white child, and questioning the beliefs that I had held for nearly 8 years. It changed my priorities because for the first time in those 8 years, I actually had something to love instead of something to hate. I didn't hate myself anymore because all my attention was focused on my wife and my child. And again, I started to really question my beliefs. And why was I doing this? At that moment, I decided I was going to take a step back. I was going to still stay the leader of this organization because I couldn't lose the three things that were important to me: identity, community, and my sense of purpose. So I was scared to lose my identity and my community because I had left everything else behind. Everything about my identity was wrapped up in this movement, in this leadership role. And everything about my community was now this new family that I had built. But my sense of purpose had shifted. My sense of purpose suddenly became my child. So I decided I was going to step back, and foolishly I didn't step back far enough, but I decided I was going to open a record store to sell white power music because I didn't want to be out on the streets anymore, but I still wasn't strong enough or courageous enough to pull away completely. So I started this record store with the intent of selling white power music, of which I was importing from Germany and from England. And it became very popular. In 1995, before the internet really took hold, people were driving from all over the country, from California or from New York, for days at a time, to buy this music, and it very quickly became 75% of the total revenue in my store. But because I didn't want to just take money from my brothers and sisters, I said, well, I'm going to take money from the enemy too. So I started to sell hip-hop and punk rock and heavy metal music, and I never thought that what happened next would happen. I started to meet, for the first time in my life, people that were the objects of my hate. And because I wanted to be a good business person, I talked to them. It was very standoffish at first when African Americans would come in or Jewish customers would come in or gay customers. I took their money and I sold them their CDs for whatever they bought, and I didn't really want to have a conversation with them. But they kept coming back. And every time they came back, the conversations became just a little bit more personal. And when the African-American teenager would tell me that his mother had been diagnosed with cancer, I understood the pain that he felt because my mother had been diagnosed with breast cancer. And when the gay couple came in holding their son and showing him so much love, I knew that they felt the same love that I felt for my own son. And suddenly I realized we had more similarities than differences. And I began to humanize them. Because the people that I hated, I never had the opportunity to engage with. Never. I was afraid of them. Hatred is born of ignorance. Fear is its father, and isolation is its mother. I was afraid of what I didn't understand. And because I was afraid, I was kept isolated from them, which just fed this fear that I had. And it wasn't until I was put in a situation, an uncomfortable situation at the time, to actually meet the people that were the objects of my hate and have a meaningful dialogue with them, that I began to realize that there was nothing to hate, that they were just like me, that we had the same fundamental struggles, joy, love, and fear. And that we needed to dialogue to get past those, to understand that we weren't that different. When I decided to pull the white power music from the shelves because I was too embarrassed to sell it in front of my new friends, I had to close the store. And at the same time I closed the store, my life kind of fell apart. And everything kind of just went black. At that time, I left the movement because I couldn't justify or reconcile my hate anymore. I lost my livelihood because I had to close my store. My wife and my two children now left me because they were not a part of the movement, and I hadn't left quickly enough. I'd ignored them for too long. I didn't have a good relationship with my family. and I had lost my whole social circle. And not only did I have to start from ground zero, but I had to start from a little bit below because I was still labeled the evil racist. Rightfully so. But my mind had started to change, and the ideology had started to fade away. Until one day, 5 years later, after suffering from a depression where every morning I felt like I wanted to take my own life because I couldn't figure out what my new way was, I had started to treat everybody else with respect and with dignity, but I had not done it to myself. I had tried to outrun my past for 5 years after I left the movement, and it was killing me from the inside out. After 5 years, a friend of mine recognized this and said, if you don't change something, we're going to lose you, and I'm not ready to do that. And she convinced me to go apply for a job at this small company called IBM. And I told her, you're crazy. Here I am, a former Nazi. I've got tattoos. I went to, you know, I didn't go to college. I got kicked out of 5 high schools, one of them twice. I don't even own a computer or know anything about computers. Why would they hire me? And she's like, oh, don't worry about it. Just tell them you're good with people. You are good with people. And I was like, okay. So I wrote my first resume, and I lied on my first resume. And after several interviews, I got the job. And of course, IBM is this massive company with millions of customers. Where could they possibly put me on my first day of work? My old high school that I got kicked out of twice to install all their computers. I was terrified. Here I was now, a grown man, and I was terrified. I was shaking and I was trembling and I didn't want to go to work, and I knew that as soon as somebody saw me at the school, even though 5 years had passed, they'd say, there's that guy, get him out of here. And I was going to lose the first thing in my life that happened that gave me hope. And of course, in the first 5 minutes of work that first day, who walks by me but the old black security guard that I'd gotten in a fist fight with that got me kicked out for the second time. He didn't see me, but I saw him, and I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to say. But I decided I had to do something. So I followed him to the parking lot. It ends better than you think. I followed him to the parking lot, and I tapped him in the shoulder when he was getting into his car. And he turned around, and this man who normally had this jolly smile, when he turned around and looked at me and recognized me, he took a step back in fear. And I didn't know what to say at that moment except for the words, I'm sorry. And I stuck out my hand, fully accepting that he wasn't going to shake it, but he did. And we talked, and we embraced, and we may have cried just a little bit, I don't remember. Okay, we cried a little bit. And after a while of talking, he made me promise one thing, that I would tell my story to anybody who would listen, because he recognized in me that I was a good kid who was searching for something and then was intercepted by somebody with an agenda. Because every young person is looking for the same things that I was looking for. I wasn't raised on racism. My parents weren't racist. The fact that they were the victims of prejudice themselves when they came to this country wasn't a foundation of who I was. But because I was searching for an identity and for a community and for a sense of purpose, and I felt vulnerable, and I was vulnerable, I happened to meet the person who changed my direction for 8 years. After working for IBM, I got tired of sitting behind a cubicle after 7 years. I decided that I wanted to do something about what this man said. I promised him that I would tell my story, but I was too scared. In 2004, I got a call in the middle of the night from my aunt, and she had told me that my younger brother had been murdered. He had been in a neighborhood that had experienced some gang trouble, and because my brother had olive skin, his skin color threatened the black teenagers that had been shot at a month before on that same street. And because they were ignorant about his skin color and they thought that he was there to do something which he was not, they murdered him. I hadn't really figured out until that point how to tell my story because I was still scared. You know, I told a couple of people close to me, but that incident really inspired me because I knew that the kids that killed my brother, and my brother included, were all victims of that search for identity, that search for community, and that search for purpose. And they had found it in the wrong way, just like I did. So I decided to start writing my book that year. It actually took me 10 years to write it. And I also started an organization called Life After Hate. And I started the organization Life After Hate because I wanted to help people that were like me, who were involved in these hate groups, who had no idea how to leave them. Because it was too difficult, even though they had lost the ideology, it was too difficult to lose that identity and to lose that community and to start over. And I'm happy to say that we are part of a large network of people, of what we call formers, former extremists, who have been part of groups like Boko Haram or Al-Qaeda or the Irish Republican Army or even inner city gangs from California and Chicago have all come together to share our knowledge with people and to help pull people out of those situations. Just Life After Hate alone, since 2009, when I co-founded the organization, we've managed to build a network of over 100 people who are former neo-Nazis who now have spent the last 10, sometimes 20 years of their lives helping pull people out of those groups. Just last year, we launched a program called Exit USA. It's kind of like a suicide hotline for racists. They can reach out to us confidentially, and we will intervene. We will help them. Sometimes we get contacted by bystanders, so it could be a parent or a family member. But through this website alone, since Election Day, we've had roughly 3 people reach out every day since November. That's a lot of people. And we've engaged with every single one of them. And I decided finally to finish that book. And it took me 10 years to write it, but I kept my promise to that man, and I did tell my story. And I wrote this book not to necessarily advertise my life and what I had been a part of, but to show people how easy it is for a young person, even somebody who's surrounded by love, to fall down the path of extremism. Because it's no different what happened to me than what happens to young girls in middle America who fly to Syria to join ISIS, or who join a street gang on the west side of Chicago. There's a distinct lack of opportunity for young people, especially when they're the most vulnerable. And as adults, I can tell you, young people, and maybe you'll agree with me, young people want to be heard, they don't want to be talked to. And we need to identify what their passions are by listening, and then by amplifying those passions for them. Because I can tell you, had somebody looked at me and said, you're a really good artist, or you're a really good athlete, or you know, maybe you like to act or play in a band or do whatever, and they would have fostered that, and they would have grown that passion inside of me, I would have gone that way, and not the way that I did. But unfortunately, nobody found that in me. Nobody took the time to find that passion. I just want to talk for a few minutes about what's happening in the world today. When we think of white supremacists, this is normally what we think about. We think about skinheads, and we think about Klansmen, and tattoos, and swastikas. And I can tell you that 30 years ago, we started a strategy that we called leaderless resistance that now is being called the alt-right. And the whole idea behind this was we were scaring away people that we could recruit. Because even to the average racist person, this was a little bit too edgy for them. And we started to say, well, why don't we grow our hair out and not get the tattoos and not wave the swastika flag? And start to just take our ideology, polish it a little bit, and make it a little bit more palatable to the masses. And instead of just talking about how bad our enemies are, why don't we focus on the grievances and use fear tactics to scare people into believing that something bad was about to happen. Here we are 30 years later, and we've traded in the hoods for suits and ties. We've started to massage the ideology and the message. And instead of calling it the Jewish media, we call it the liberal media. Instead of calling it Zionism, we call it globalism. I mean, we just, you know, there are people that use just slightly nicer words. But I can tell you that because of the internet, everything has changed. The whole ballgame has changed. Because those skinheads and those Klansmen now are using a very tailored message to reach millions of young people, vulnerable young people, who maybe don't fit in real life and who have a grievance. They're sitting behind millions of computer screens looking for a narrative. And I can tell you that if, as a young person, if you don't create your own narrative, somebody will create it for you. So what used to look like this now looks like this. Probably like some of your daughters or granddaughters. They blend in. The ideology has become mainstream and normalized. And they look like this. Not what you would consider a neo-Nazi or white supremacist if you were just to look at them. And while everybody is patting themselves on the back saying, oh, we've, you know, membership in hate groups has gone down, we're doing a good job, and I say, no, you've taken your eye off the ball. Because 30 years ago, that was our intent, was to make it an invisible empire. So while they may still be saluting, walking down the streets, you wouldn't recognize them, and boy, are they getting younger and younger and more violent. There is a problem on the internet, and I am a supporter of the internet and free speech and internet rights. However, we have a problem. We have a problem with propaganda and with fake news, where young people are going down a rabbit hole because of the algorithms that we have on the internet. Just like when you go to Amazon and it tells you to buy a product, or you buy a product and it says, oh, you'd really like this product. Same thing happens with news on social media. If you click on a fake news story, oftentimes it will recommend more of those types of stories to your feed. And it's so hard with all the information that's out there to distinguish what is real news, what is propaganda, what is fake news, what's parody. And young people, because they're so disenfranchised with what's going on in the world today, because they feel so disconnected from everything, are finding these narratives and they're falling down this rabbit hole. He's an example of this. This is Dylan Roof, who walked into a church in South Carolina and murdered 9 innocent people for praying to God and for the color of their skin. And he was radicalized because when he heard about the Trayvon Martin shooting, he went and he Googled black on white crime statistics. And he stumbled on a series of fake news sites that inflated those numbers. And because of that, he went out and he murdered 9 innocent people. I want to now introduce you to Crusader Girl and just tell you a little bit of a story about her. I met her in September. Her parents emailed me because their 17-year-old daughter was making hateful propaganda videos online, neo-Nazi propaganda videos, denying the Holocaust, talking about, you know, Jewish connections to the Clinton campaign, all this propaganda that was going around. And they were concerned because she had this 23-year-old boyfriend who had recruited her and was writing the scripts for these videos. Well, when I started to do a little bit of research, she's 17, he was 23, I was already concerned that there was an underage component to it. But I started to do some research, and as I started to research it, this 23-year-old boyfriend from Idaho, well, he wasn't from Idaho. And he wasn't 23. In fact, the deeper I got and the more I got, I found out that he was doing this not only to her but to several other girls at the same time, where he'd become their boyfriend, virtual boyfriend. They'd never seen each other. They'd only talked and chatted and texted. He was getting compromising photos from these young girls because he was their boyfriend, and he was blackmailing them. And when they decided to leave the movement or stop making videos, he would essentially post their videos online on porn sites. The deeper I got and the more I started to look into it, I started to realize that not only was this guy connected to these girls, but he was also connected to other people who were creating hundreds of thousands of fake social media profiles in support of Trump. And they were using chatbots, these automatic artificial intelligence algorithms, to tweet out and engage with people to skew election trending and polling. Not only were they creating these white nationalists, hundreds of thousands of white nationalist accounts that were pro-Trump, but they were also creating fake Black Lives Matter accounts and fake jihadist accounts, all to put out really inflammatory information toward each other so that they would rile all the sides up. The deeper I looked, after about 2 months, I discovered that there was a Russian connection to this. Surprise. This was October. The first time we heard about a Russian connection in the news with either election tampering or any kind of influence was in December when the CIA claims they discovered it. Well, I reported it to the FBI in October and nobody did anything about it. So I can tell you that this exists. This isn't just something that we hear on television. I have 25 gigabytes of evidence that I've collected just on this case alone. But this is the way that things are going. This is the way that young people are being influenced. And I only mention this case because I'm sure most of you have young people who live online or live on their phones. And we have to be careful about what we consume, because what we consume is not always the truth. I changed when I started to receive compassion from the people that I least deserved it from, when I least deserved it. Young people are going down this rabbit hole and they're never having the opportunity to connect with those people because they're keeping themselves in this virtual world and only communicating with each other. And in order to change this narrative, we all have to do our part. We all have to touch the people around us, the people closest to us, our family, our coworkers, our friends, and impart what it is that we know about the goodness of people, that we have this innate basic human goodness. Because if we don't do that, if we just focus on solving racism, it's too big of a problem to even like wrap your head around. So touch the people that are closest to you, make an impact with them, and hope that they will go out and make an impact with others. And strive to really connect with the people that either think you're too different or that you think are too different, because those are the people that need it the most. Those are the people that need to understand that human connection the most. So I'll just leave you with one challenge before we wrap up, and then we'll do some questions afterwards. I want you to find somebody outside of this community today, tomorrow, every day, that you think doesn't deserve compassion, and show it to them. And see how that changes them and how it changes you. And showing compassion to the people you don't think need it, chances are good that they're the ones who need it the most. So go out there and make good happen. Thank you very much.
You said a quote, and I didn't start writing it down until the end. The end was, the fear is the father, the isolation is the mother. What was the beginning of that?
Hatred is born of ignorance, fear is its father, and isolation is its mother.
Hatred is born of ignorance.
Fear is its father, and isolation its mother.
Thank you.
And that's mine.
Hi, thanks for your talk. I have lots of questions, but I guess I'll just ask, how much do you think our current leader of our free world knew about the people that were helping him, and do you have any views to the basket of deplorables and what should have been done instead and so forth?
Well, I think without getting too political, I really think that he's an opportunist and that there are people in his cabinet who are very, very aware. And I really don't think he believes a word that he says. I don't think that he knows exactly what he's saying, but I do believe that his cabinet know very, very well how they're positioning themselves and what they're doing. A lot of the rhetoric that they're saying, that they've said through the campaign and even into the presidency, were almost verbatim what I would have said 30 years ago in one of my speeches. You know, calling for a ban on immigration or calling for a registration or even calling for an ethno state, meaning a white homeland, which, you know, several people in his cabinet have been rumored to say. You know, I judge people on actions, not on words. And there were so many people willing to give him the benefit of the doubt on his words that I was just not, because everything that he has said, he's done. And I was not going to give him the benefit of the doubt to do those things. I mean, if he said he's going to do them. I'm concerned. I'm alarmed. I think we should all be, because there are certainly things that are happening right now with our administration that I would consider very, very un-American, very undemocratic, with a capital D. And it concerns me. And, you know, I certainly am trying to educate people on this, on the connections. But I also don't want to speculate. You know, there's a lot of speculation happening in the media and with people. And, you know, it's being fed, I think, in a large part by our president. But I would say that we should be very, very cautious and that we should not stand for any desecration of rights that we believe in as Americans against anybody of color. We shouldn't see our rights erode away that we've worked very, very hard for, that we've struggled over, you know, a century and a half to get for people. We don't want to see those rolled back in one administration or destroyed altogether. So, I, you know, we need to stay vigilant and do something. Whatever you can. Touch the people around you. If you're a teacher, teach differently. If you're an artist, make more inclusive art. If you're a parent, parent better. There's always something that we can do. While we may not all be protesters who go out there and, you know, wave a sign, and that's fine too, we can all affect the world in a different way.
Hi.
Oh, there you go.
First, I just want to start out by saying thank you for all the work that you're doing. I think it's amazing. And
my pleasure.
Any way that we can support you, please let us know, because that's great. I have two questions. One's
sure.
Kind of on the personal side, and one is, again, sort of on the
political
side.
You can ask anything you want, personal or not. My life is literally an open book.
The personal question is, you know, you mentioned your parents, and I was just kind of wondering how they responded to the activities that you started, especially at such a young age. And I mean, I know you mentioned they were working really hard and sort of a little bit absent, but at some point they must have become aware of your activities, and I was just wondering how they responded. And then second part of my question is, this morning I read an article about Steve Bannon and his association with a particular book that was news to me, but you are probably aware of, called The Camp of Saints. And I just kind of want...
calling for the destruction of society, the collapse of society.
Yeah, I don't know if you've read it or if you're familiar with it. If you're not familiar with it, then skip that question. I guess it's a French book from the 70s that's about evil immigration. But anyway, yeah, so let's just talk about your parents.
You know, at first, my parents didn't even know. Like, for the first year or two, I was pretty good at keeping, teenagers are pretty good at keeping stuff from their parents, or they think they are until they screw up. And then I screwed up by having the police bring me home one night, and I think that they figured it out very, very quickly what I was involved in. And they were terrified. They were so worried, because my parents are great people. They really loved me. They just didn't know how to be American parents. They didn't know what it meant to, you know, have your child exposed to, you know, different things that were happening on the street. I mean, they came from this very small village of, you know, 1,500 people, so it was kind of like a culture shock to them. And they still kind of live in that bubble, I think. But I have a great relationship with my parents now. My mother calls me way too much. But she hasn't learned how to text message yet, so I'm still in good shape. And when they figured out that, you know, what I was involved in, they were scared for me. They were, you know, worried if I was going to come home at all, or if the police were going to bring me home, or if they'd get a phone call, you know, saying I was in jail or dead. And they tried everything they could, but they didn't really know what to do. I don't know that any parent really knows what to do, except for surround your child with love. And they continued to do that through the ups and downs, and they did some things that worked and some things that pushed me away even further, but they tried, and they never stopped trying, which was the important part. Because I fell back eventually into that person that I was before 14 years old. That person who was shy and who did love people and, you know, was a very good kid and loved to draw, and it brought me back. So I was very lucky to have parents like that.
Hi, Christian.
Hi.
You have such smiling eyes and a happy vibration. It's hard for me to imagine you back then.
Thank you.
My question is about... My question is, well, my comment is, it's amazing about that young girl online. It really hit home. Like, it really helped me understand. It's just like right in front of me. Would you consider, or are you considering going to another entity aside from the FBI at this time, considering what's happening?
Yeah, I have been working with other agencies. What was really interesting about that situation is this was back in October, so it was just before Election Day when I kind of discovered this. And when I went to the FBI, they said, this is interesting, but we're reading Hillary's emails right now. We'll look at it when we can. And now I suspect that they're even busier than, you know, they were reading Hillary's emails, reading, you know, who knows what's going on. But I have been working with other people there on top of it. It's something that they're taking very seriously because it's a real issue. I also should mention, too, that after I presented to this 17-year-old girl what I had found and her parents, she didn't believe me. And she went and told her boyfriend, and 75 domain names that I own for websites that are both for my nonprofit, for businesses, my mom's restaurant, things like that, we're all hacked by Russian hackers within an hour. My mother was called and you know, tried to fish for information. My wife started to receive, you know, social media threats. It was really an interesting time, and it hasn't stopped. So it's all good. Because I was able to track IP addresses to past criminal activity.
Hi, I'm to your left.
I'm smarter than they were.
First of all, thanks so much for sharing your story, which is just really interesting. And my question, you alluded to the fact that you cleverly figured out a while ago that you had to reshape what you guys looked like.
Yeah.
And as someone who's supported the Southern Poverty Law Center for 157 years or whatever, my concern has always been exactly that. They have kind of a way they think about it, which I am grateful for, and I think they've done a ton that helps, but it's always kind of this cat and mouse game, right? Where the bad guys are always a little bit smarter than the good guys. And so the question is, what, if anything, whether it's them or other groups that are trying to help do this, what's the right way without starting to assume everybody who looks like everybody is the bad guy? Like, what's the right new strategy that we need to think about to be a little bit more ahead of it instead of behind it?
We need to listen. We need to listen more than we point the finger or we talk. Because there's a whole lot of finger-pointing happening right now. There's a lot of, you know, polarization, a lot of division. There's not a whole lot of listening. And I think that, you know, it might seem a little Pollyannish to say, you know, we need to treat people with compassion, even if they don't deserve it or we don't think that they deserve it. But I can tell you that out of the hundreds of people that I've worked with, every single one of them says, I changed when the people that I hated showed me love, and I realized that they weren't the people that I hated. So, you know, when you say, you know, hugging a Nazi doesn't work, I can tell you it does, kind of, because that's what's worked for me and for all the people that I know. There is a lot of stuff out there. We need to listen. We can't just say that people's opinions are wrong, even if we know with all of our heart that it is. We need to just work to educate the people around us and try to reach those people with compassion until they realize that what they believe is wrong. until what they believe, until they recognize what they believe is hurtful to other people. Because I guarantee you that the people like Richard Spencer and these alt-right people that we keep hearing about, they've never had a meaningful dialogue with anybody that they hate. Because if they did, they wouldn't be able to reconcile their hate anymore. So while they're changing their appearances and changing their, you know, packaging and even changing the words that they use, the intent is the same. Anytime somebody is seeking to divide or isolate, it's always because of fear. Because there is nothing to fear. Diversity is a beautiful thing. I look around this room and I see diversity. And I look around, well, there are women here, there are people of color here. There could be a little bit more color, I think. But diversity is always something, I mean, let's face it, as Americans, our greatest import has always been immigrants. We are America and we are great because of the diversity that we've always let into our country. Always. So we need to listen and we need to just connect people. We need to build bridges rather than tear them down.
Hi. My name's Megan. I really wanted to thank you. I've been close to tears the whole time you've been talking.
Oh, thank you, Megan.
For one thing, it seems to me that you were so into this and you got out so young. And, you know, I guess you said your parents, you know, were always there. What do you think happened to Steve Bannon? What makes a person like that? Because he has to have talked to, you know, I mean, he talks to black people. I mean, I guess he's never really talked to them, though.
I don't know.
You know, any other.
Yeah, I don't know.
He seems to hate everybody.
Yeah.
And he's the one I'm really afraid of.
Well, I'm afraid of a couple of them.
Well, yeah, I know. Well, yeah.
But no, I understand what you're saying. I mean, I don't know what happened to Steve Bannon. At some point, he was angry about something, probably angry about himself in some way, and he chose to really project that anger onto somebody else. I think he is also an opportunist. I also think that it comes from an ego instead of a heart. It's not emotional, or it is emotional. It's not rational.
I suspect drug use. I mean, I look at him. Well, you look at him. I wouldn't say that. Can I ask another question?
Of course.
I have a semi-cousin who is, you know, very much a Democrat, but he's really, really, you know, upset about, you know, the alt-right movement. And he believes that he should yell at them and call them Nazis, and that he should call them Nazis until they go and read a book and realize that they're Nazis, and then they'll wake up and realize. And
your cousin they already know they're Nazis. They're just... using language that makes them not look like Nazis.
I've tried to talk. I don't know how to reach him. He's young. You know, he's in Seattle. I don't know.
Long distance, it's hard, but I would encourage him to really interface with people that are different than him. Because inevitably, he's going to meet people that he feels comfortable associating with that are completely different, that may challenge his belief system. That's what I do. I mean, when I work with people, I always immerse them. You know, first I listen. I listen for potholes. I call them potholes. When I work with somebody in an intervention situation, I listen for the potholes. What is missing in their life that caused them to go down that path to begin with? Is it a lack of education? Is it the inability to find a job? Is it the fact that, you know, you have trauma or psychological issues or tattoos or whatever? And then when I hear what those potholes are, I become a construction worker and I start to fill those potholes. And I do that with job training, with education. But the most important thing that I do is immersion. I will introduce them to the people that they hate. They don't know it sometimes. I'll tell you a specific story really quickly because I know we want to get more questions in. But there was a 31-year-old man from Buffalo who was a wounded military veteran. Had a beautiful wife and a beautiful child, and he read my book and he reached out and he said, I have some questions. And I said, sure, let's talk. And I started to talk to him on the phone and he said, I hate Muslims. And I said, Okay, why do you hate Muslims? Well, they're evil. Okay, why are they evil? Well, you know, they believe in pedophilia and they just want to behead us and destroy Christianity. He was a Christian. I said, okay, well, what makes you believe that? He said, well, that's what I've heard. And, you know, I said, okay, well, that's fine. So let's. We kept talking and talking. And one day he called me and he said, you know, I'm fed up. I was in the park walking my daughter, walking my dog with my daughter, and I saw a Muslim man praying in my park, and all I wanted to do was go and kick him in the face. And I said, okay, dude, I'm flying to Buffalo tomorrow. Take the day off of work. And went to Buffalo, and I met with him, and after talking to him, he was very, you know, lovely house, lovely wife, really nice guy. After talking to him, I finally asked him, like, so how many Muslims have you met? And he's like, none. Why would I want to meet them? I see them, and they're just evil, and they want to kill me. Why would I want to talk to them? They're the enemy. I said, okay. Can I use your bathroom? And he said, yeah, it's down the hallway. And I took my phone and found the local mosque, and I called the mosque, and I said, I talked to the imam. I said, imam, I have a man here, a Christian man, who wants to learn about your religion. Can we come over and talk to you? I couldn't really tell him what was going on, or he'd say no. But and he said, yes, of course, but I only have 15 minutes before prayer service. You know, please come by as soon as you can. I said, okay, we're in the car. And I said, all right, we're going to go grab some lunch. And, you know, we got in the car, and, you know, halfway there, I was like, well, we need to stop somewhere first. And I told him, and he's like, turn around, like, I want to throw up. I was like, I don't care, it's a rental car, throw up. And we got there, and finally, after some convincing, I knocked on the door, and the imam answered, and he said, I've only got, you know, 10 minutes before I have to prepare for my prayer service, but come in, come in. Well, we were there for 3 hours talking to the imam, and they were talking about their religion, and they, you know, were crying and hugging, and we were all like, you know, stupid looking wet faces. And before he left, he found out, gosh, my religion is really similar to your religion. How about that? And I can say now, and I'm very happy to say this, that this man actually goes to the mosque and helps set up chairs and cooks for them. And every Friday, he goes out to lunch for falafel with his new best friend, the imam. It's those connections that we have to make with each other, because, like I said, what was my quote? Hate is based on ignorance, fear is its father, and isolation is its mother. He was afraid of what he didn't understand, and he was so isolated from it that he never had the opportunity to understand it.
Hi, Christian. I have a question on the concert you had in Germany, just the chronology of it. Was it before or after the unification? And
after.
How did 91. You get permission to do that? I thought that was illegal in Germany.
It is very illegal to do what I did. It is very illegal to display a swastika or to give a Sieg Heil salute or to even deny the Holocaust. It is very illegal. I could have been arrested for what I did there. But it was after. It was 91, so it was several years after the unification.
I have a question.
Yes.
The question is, people, most high schools, including parochial high schools, learn science very well by the time even an average kid will learn very good, that only there is one human species in the world. Okay? Then they are born the same way, everybody, and their opportunities are different, but still, they don't believe that in real life. They think they're superior, and the fact after Trump election shows very good people, large number of people still believe in sectarianism, racism, and all kind of segregationism for their own benefit. Why do you think that is happening?
I think because when people have problems, it's much easier to blame somebody else for those problems rather than to reflect internally and realize that maybe you are the cause of some of those problems. So when people hate, I really do believe it's because there's a part of themselves that they really hate, that they're very ashamed of, that they can't be accountable for some reason. And it's easier to put the blame on somebody else and project that pain away. So even though we do learn about science and the fact that we're all organisms made up of the exact same molecules and components and that, you know, there really is no difference other than what the propaganda tells us. We still go off and are affected by instances or grievances or even people that we meet that cause us to think a certain way. It's like we lose our innocence at a certain point. Somebody touches us and changes our trajectory. But if that can happen because of science, yay science, we can also touch people in a way that sets their trajectory on a positive path.
Hey there. I was listening to the music from White American Youth.
I'm sorry.
And I noticed that, you could buy it on Amazon, singles. Would you be profiting if, for example, they sold millions?
I've tried for years to have my music removed. It was removed from iTunes. I've never profited off my music, even when I was in the movement. Interesting thing about the movement, and I'm going to surprise you here and say that they're very selfish people. so they, you know, are very good at stealing music from people, bootlegging it. I have tried for years to try and get my, sometimes successfully, to get my music removed, but unfortunately, it's like playing whack-a-mole. Somebody always just puts it up. Same thing with the videos. Like this young girl who was making the videos, she's totally out of the movement now. Like I've worked with her. She's making videos against it. She's had a change of heart. They keep, even though she's removed all her prior videos, her old friends keep posting them. So it's something that will never go away for her.
First of all, thank you for coming and speaking to us today.
It's my pleasure.
The question that I have, many of the people in this room, we share similar beliefs and similar philosophies, and that's why we're all here and we're listening to you. And most of us live in Chicago or the suburbs, and we're surrounded by other people who are like-minded. Do you have any thoughts on ways to facilitate interactions with people who have these vastly different mindsets? Because it's not a space that I am aware of operating in. You know, I can't say I can reach out to this person and show them compassion because that person isn't obvious to me.
That's a question I get asked every time I do a talk. And all I can say is you have to be the message. Don't go looking for these people. I mean, if you see them, you can engage with them, but you don't have to look for them. Just act the way you want the world to be, and it will affect everybody you touch. At the grocery, you'll touch people that are like that you don't even know that you're touching. Be the message. But if you do see somebody, like I said, engage with them, but listen. Don't challenge them ideologically. I never battle ideologically because that just pushes us farther apart. I listen for those potholes and then find a way to be construction worker.
This is a perfect lead-in, actually. One, I appreciate so much that you say it's with every person that you touch. And as a millennial, because I clearly am, the reality is that there's this whole, the millennials want to save the world, they want to go against the norm. And on some level, it's true, but I love that you touch on every single person, because that's what I've been telling my friends. So my first question is, when are you speaking again? Because I'd like to bring them. Yeah. Absolutely. By far the best
talk. When will you have me back?
where are you going? No, so one, I think that people need to hear that. And like he said, it really isn't just about that, you know, big group or that really different looking person. It's essentially anywhere and everywhere. So I love that. Secondly, how do we get involved in your nonprofit? That is my, you need a PR person? Because I'm right there.
We need everything except for former Nazis, I guess. I mean, we need those too because that's our business. But good question. So to address the first part, we do have to touch everybody. And the thing with millennials is she's very right. They do want to save the world. But some people will get in front of them that will convince them that they're saving the world, just like I thought I was saving the world for those 8 years. So we have to be very careful of that. They're angry. They get out of college with debt. They don't have prospects for a job. They have to, you know, in some instances live with their parents. Like, yeah. Right? Can you relate? Yeah. Okay. They really want to do something. We need to enable them because they have the motivation. They just don't have the tools. We have the tools and we just don't have the motivation. We have the experience. We need to transfer that to people. We need to listen because they don't want to be talked to. They want to be heard. What was the second part? Where am I speaking? How can you support? Well, you can go to lifeafterhate.org. We are a very grassroots nonprofit. There are five of us that are staff members, but we're all volunteers. You can donate. There's a donate link on our website, or you can spread the word if you can't donate. We can use volunteers in every industry, from website design to legal to accounting to PR to social media. We're very good at de-radicalizing people. Unfortunately, we don't have the time to do the other things that we're good at, like fundraising and social media and things like that, because there are so few of us. We also need to focus our energy not just on the interventions, on people that need our help, but training other formers like us to do those interventions so that we can scale. Because of that, all the rest of the business administrative stuff kind of takes a back seat to that, just because there aren't enough of us. So we, you know, email me, and I can definitely point you in the right direction if there's a skill, if there's, as far as time, like, just go out there and be a good person. Like, that's all we want you to be. Like, you don't have to do that on our behalf. Like, just go out there and be a good person. But if you do have a certain skill that you think you can lend, we're always looking for help. But more than anything else, just let people know that we exist so that the people who need the help can find us.
Fabulous talk. First of all, I'm now embarrassed wearing this T-shirt, which is offensive to racists. And seriously, I mean, I really mean it. I say this is probably the wrong approach.
I would say when I was in those years, my brain was as big as a walnut.
Okay. So my question is, how intoxicating is it to be a bully, to scare somebody?
Oh, it was the most powerful thing for me. To go from this very powerless, like, short, bad-haired kid with a terrible last name that everybody would mangle until the cows came home. You know, it's Picciolini, but people would basically say anything weenie. Pick my weenie, you know. I just, like, it was relentless. So, yeah, tell me your question again. I went off on it.
As a teacher, how intoxicating is it?
Very, okay. So for somebody who was powerless, the power or the perceived power was the number one thing that kept me in and that kept me going. I can tell you that the racism was almost superficial. Like, it became superficial. Like, to me, it was all about the power. It was about the manipulation. It was about going from somebody who was a nobody to being somebody who was everybody. And that was very intoxicating. It was like a drug, very much so.
We have time for maybe one more question here.
Okay.
Yeah, hi. You mentioned your tattoos a couple times. Have you kept all your tattoos?
I've gotten most of them covered up. I think all except for one. And I was going to. And it's this one here, and most people wouldn't even... It's like Scandinavian runes, Viking runes. And most people don't know that that's associated with the white supremacist movement unless you're really in the white supremacist movement or you study it. And I was going to get it covered up. But one day, I was walking down the street, and a guy came up to me, and he's like, "Cool tattoo, bro, white power." And I was like, "Cool, bro, let's talk." So I decided to keep it, at least for now. I probably will get it covered up at some point. But it was a good icebreaker for me to actually work with somebody. So. Oh, I have tattoos everywhere. The bad ones have been covered up with new tattoos. Better tattoos. No. Covered with tattooed over tattoos to cover the bad ones. Yeah. It's like drawing over another drawing to make it into something else. There are people that are very good at that. I am not one of them.
Okay, thank you.